I wonder how much William Shakespeare would be worth nowadays if he was paid all of the royalties for his plays, sonnets, and all the other things he wrote, including many of the phrases that we use nowadays in English. Oh my goodness. Oh, hello there. Here we go. We are here together again. Yes, we've made it to the end of another week. And yes, it is another English Addict live from the birthplace of English, which just happens to be... Wow! I don't believe it. It's England! Hi everybody, this is Mr. Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I hope so. Are you happy? I hope so. I'm feeling tired today. I'm going to get this out of the way first of all. Can I just say I'm feeling tired today? The reason is because I didn't go to bed until 4:30 this morning. And it's all your fault. It's your fault. Can you believe it? I did not get much sleep last night because of you. I was busy editing something that we are going to see today. Last night we went into the kitchen. Yes, we have another 15 minutes of cooking with Mr. Steve in the kitchen coming up later on. But I did have to stay awake almost all night editing it. It went on slightly longer than it should have, to be honest. It did go on a little bit too long. So I managed, after spending many hours sitting in front of the computer, I managed to edit the actual video footage down from 50 minutes down to 15 minutes, which took quite a long time. So that coming up today, yes, we are once more cooking in the kitchen. For those who don't know who I am, my name is Duncan. I talk about the English language and I've been doing it for ever such a long time. Do you know how long? Over 14 years. And still, I'm still waiting for my play button from YouTube. They haven't sent it to me. 14 years, almost 900,000 subscribers, 76 million views, no play button. It's not very nice, is it? If you want to complain on my behalf, feel free. You can write to YouTube and say, "Dear YouTube, I think it's terrible that Mr. Duncan still doesn't have his play button, that he can hang on the wall, and every day he will walk by and look at it proudly, thinking of all those days and nights that he spent preparing his YouTube videos." Anyway, it looks like it's not going to happen, but am I going to complain? Am I upset? Am I dispirited? Yes, yes I am. It's not fair. Anyway, as I mentioned, we have Mr. Steve coming a little bit later on. We also have the sentence game coming up today. I will try to do the sentence game a little bit earlier today. I will try to do it earlier. I've had some complaints, you see, from people saying, "Here, Mr. Duncan, I wish you would play the sentence game a little earlier instead of waiting until 20 minutes before the end of your show." So we will try to do it earlier today. I will try my best. But as you know, I cannot control Mr. Steve. He is uncontrollable. I have tried. I've even taken him to the local vet here in Much Wenlock. There is nothing they can do about it. They've tried everything. They've tried spraying water in his face, but he just won't shut up. So Mr. Steve coming later on. Yes, we've made it to the end of not only another week, but also another weekend as well. Yes, it's Sunday. Yeah. It's Sunday. I hope you're having a good weekend. How has it been where you are? Has it been a good one, or has it been a load of rubbish? I don't know, you see, because I'm not there. It's a lovely day outside. I don't know what was going on last night, but we had the most horrendous storm during the night, and I was a little worried that my Christmas lights would be damaged. Fortunately, they're not, but right now outside, look at the weather now. I can't believe how lovely it is outside. So yes, that is, for those who are wondering, that is actually a live view right now in England. So that's what England looks like out of my studio window. You can see that autumn is definitely in the air, as many of the trees are now losing their leaves. Some of them have lost their leaves already. So that is the view right now outside. I hope it is satisfactory. If it isn't, then I'm not sure what I'm going to do, really. I can't really change the view outside. I suppose I could try, but I don't think I will be successful. I have no control over that, you see. Yes, Mr. Steve will be here. What are we cooking in the kitchen? That is the question. What are we going to cook in the kitchen today? Find out later on. But there is a clue, a little clue, in the thumbnail, the photograph that was advertising today's live stream. There is a slight clue there, you see. Oh, I thought today we would do something else as well, something we haven't done for a long time. I thought we would have a mystery object. Would you like a mystery object? So we will do that straight away, I think. Here is the mystery object. Today's mystery object looks something like this. Oh, there it is. It is on the screen right now. So today's mystery object, I will show it to Mr. Steve a little bit later on to see what he thinks it might be. So there it is, today's mystery object. Oh, but what is it? If you don't know, well, don't worry. I will tell you the answer later on. Also, I suppose we should take a look at my socks today. What socks am I wearing? Let's have a look, shall we? Oh, they are very colourful socks. I have my colourful socks. We have yellow, blue, red, green, a little bit of navy blue at the end where my toes are. Look, my feet look very comfortable today, I must admit. Oh, what's going on? Oh, it looks as if my feet are becoming very romantically involved. Oh, what's going on there? Now, come on, feet. Stop it. Stop doing that. There might be adults watching. It's disgusting, isn't it? Did you see what my feet were doing then? They were getting very amorous. Oh, I like that word. The word amorous, it describes the action of two people showing their affection. If you are feeling amorous, you want some sort of physical or romantic contact. Maybe with a person you have your eye on. Maybe someone you've seen across the street. Maybe a beautiful girl or a handsome boy. And you've seen them and you wish you could be amorous. You are feeling amorous. Or maybe a couple who have been dating for a long time. Maybe when they meet, they feel amorous. They feel as if they want to experience the feeling of love. Some people say that love is overrated. Ooh, what do you think? So here we go again. Yes, what is happening with the situation concerning lockdown? I don't want to talk about it too much, but yes, we are still in lockdown here in the UK. Of course, you know me. I'm very optimistic. I always try to look on the bright side of life. whenever I can. So don't worry, I am fine here. I don't have any illness. I don't have any bugs or viruses. So yes, I'm still okay, despite the fact that quite a few people now in Much Wenlock have actually tested positive for that thing. Yes, you know what I'm talking about. Your socks are very beautiful on the live chat. I've almost forgotten the live chat. Oh, I'm very sorry about that. I wonder who was first on today's live chat. Of course, don't forget, you are more than welcome to get in touch. You can actually get involved right now. If you are sitting in front of your computer or your mobile device, you can actually get involved. You can open the chat box and you can actually send your messages right now at 22 minutes past 2 o'clock on Sunday the 15th of November. We are now halfway through November. Can you believe it? So the big question is, who was first on today's live stream? Oh, hello, Mosen. Oh, Mosen, you have a very fast finger. Your finger is very fast. Congratulations, you are first on today's live stream and also the live chat. Something is annoying me. I have something up my nose which is really annoying me. I have a little hair. Now, one of the things you find as you get older, you find that you get hair in places where you don't want it. And then, of course, the places where you do want your hair, it disappears. It vanishes. It's one of the strange things in life, I suppose. So you might lose the hair on your head. Your head hair, your head hair might disappear. But fortunately, nature has a backup planner, because it will give you hair everywhere else, in places where you never thought you could actually get hair. I have hair in very strange places. On my ears. So not in my ears, but actually on my earlobes. So right here, I actually have hair growing from my earlobes. But of course, I also have hair at my nose. And today, I don't know why, there is a little hair in my nose. And it is itching. It is scratching inside my nose. It's very distracting, to be honest. Congratulations, Mosen. Yes, you are first on today's live chat. Vitas, you are in second place. Your finger today was not quite quick enough. I suggest you get some exercises. Maybe you could do some press-ups, or maybe lift some weights with your fingers to train them so they will be very fast on your mouse. So better luck next time. Julie G. Belarusia is here. Hello, Belarusia. Nice to see you here. I think maybe you are looking after your father today, but it is great to see you here. Beatrice is here. Valeria is here. Olga is here. Han. Hello, Han. Nice to see you as well. Oh, we have Luis Mendez is here today. Hello, Luis. We also have Partap. Hello, Partap. Is it your birthday again? Are you having another fake birthday today? By the way, can I say happy Diwali to those who are celebrating the Festival of Light? I hope you have a nice, bright time. Hello also to Thang Nguyen, who I believe is watching in Vietnam. A big xin chào to those watching in Vietnam. Thomas, we also have Jenny Vu. I used to work for a girl many years ago. The strange thing is, I've just thought, in my life, most of the bosses, most of the people I've ever worked for were actually women. So in my life, many years ago, we are going back many years, I have had many jobs, and but every time I've done it, I've had a female boss. What about you? Does it worry you if you are a man? Now, I know this is very controversial, but if you are a man, does it bother you working for a woman? Now, I remember when I was telling people, my friends, about the fact that I work for a woman, they said, how can you do that? How can you work for a woman? Now, I will be honest with you, it didn't bother me. In fact, we used to have quite a lot of laughs, actually. So it didn't really bother me. But yes, I could understand maybe some people might object to working for a woman, maybe a man who has his macho image to worry about. Maybe he will be a little emasculated by working for a woman. Now, there is an interesting word, emasculate. If you emasculate a man, you take away his feeling of masculinity. So some men will imagine this, you see. They will think that if they work for a woman, it will take away their masculinity. They will be less manly. As far as I'm concerned, that is not true. I used to have so much fun with my female bosses. I really did. I think most of the time we did not do any work. I think it's safe to say. I think for most of the time we talked and drank coffee. Very little work took place. Hello, Lolly Lolly. Hello also. Oh, hello, Sidra. Hello, Sidra. Nice to see you here today. I'm feeling tired today. I'm feeling a little bit sleepy because I didn't go to bed until 4:30 this morning. So I'm feeling a little tired. Hiroko. Hello, Hiroko. Nice to see you here as well. Any ideas? Any clues on today's mystery object? Does anyone know what this is? Do you know what the mystery object is? Can you name it? Hello also. Oh, we have Jovan. Hello, Jovan. I don't recognize your name. I am always interested to find out if it is your first time here. I always like to know where you are in the world, because the world is a big place full of many different people. So sometimes it is nice to know where you are watching right now, you see. Hello, Mr. Duncan. Oh, thank you, Jovan. That's very kind of you. Grace. I am saying Grace. I am saying hello to Grace. Hello, Gigi. Oh, Mr. Duncan, we like your beard. Ah. Now, it would appear that the opinion is a little bit divided. So some people like my beard and some people don't. So quite a few people have written to me, thank you very much, saying, Mr. Duncan, we like your beard. It makes you look very sexy. You look like maybe, I suppose, Sean Connery. He had a beard. There are many actors nowadays who have beards. And now I have one. So some people like my beard and some people don't. But apparently, Gigi Kane says, Mr. Duncan, your beard suits you. It suits you very much. You look younger and prettier. Thank you very much. I'm not sure if it makes me look younger. See, I think this makes me look more mature, more older, in fact. Sidra, nice to see you here as well today. Yes, we are in the kitchen. I suppose I must warn you that today we will be cooking some meat as well. So besides vegetables, there will be some meat as well in today's video. So I should warn you, because there might be some vegetarians or vegans out there. So I'm just going to say that now. I'm going to put it out there right now. Hello also, Alessandra. Oh, hello, Ben Jaloon again. That's very kind of you. Mr. Duncan, can you please send us the picture of the shining lamps of last time. The shining lamps. I wonder what lamps you mean. Well, I have been putting up my Christmas lights over the past few days. So let me just show you. Over the past few days, I have been putting my Christmas lights. There are some of my Christmas lights. And now they are hanging at the front of my house. One of the interesting things about Christmas lights. Now, this is something that I did not know. But I realized, apparently, people can complain. They actually can complain about Christmas lights. So here in the UK, there is a law that can be used to stop people from having Christmas lights on their house, which I think is a little bit mean, to be honest. Who would complain about Christmas lights? I think Christmas lights are fantastic. They make everything look so beautiful and bright and cheerful. And let's face it, during these very strange times, I think we all need cheering up. So, no, I love Christmas lights. I like to see the lights flashing and twinkling. In fact, last week I did a live stream where I was on the roof. And I was doing a live stream. Who remembers the moment last week when Mr. Steve suddenly appeared? Do you remember? I was on the roof and then suddenly Mr. Steve appeared at the window. And, well, let's just say he nearly gave me a heart attack.
Ever. Sorry about that. Mr. Steve is actually at the window. There's Mr. Steve. Can you see Mr. Steve? There's Mr. Steve. It would appear that we can't get away from Mr. Steve. Whatever is get. Hello, Mr. Steve.
Did I just shock you, Mr. Duncan?
Steve just gave me a big shock then. I wasn't expecting to see Mr. Steve at the window. Yes, you did. You did. You frightened the life out of me then. Are you okay, Steve? Is that
I'm
it?
I'm fine.
Yes.
I'm well.
You should be working.
I know. I'm going back now.
Get back to work.
Don't want to get told off.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
So we can never get away from Mr. Steve. I'm sorry about that. Did you see that?
So there I was last week on the roof putting up my Christmas lights. And of course, I am going to show you my Christmas lights. I haven't turned them on yet. I am going to switch my Christmas lights on the 1st of December. So the first day of December, I'm going to turn my Christmas lights on, but not yet. I think at the moment it's a little bit too early, to be honest. I think it's slightly too early to actually switch on my Christmas lights, even though a lot of people have already done it. So here in England, can you believe it? Whilst many people are in their houses and they can't go out, a lot of people have decided to celebrate Christmas early this year, so they've started the festivities much earlier than normal. So that's what they're doing. Anyway, we should have Mr. Steve with us soon, but we are going to have a little break. We're going to have a look at one of my full English lessons. For those who are wondering, what do you do, Mr. Duncan, besides this? Well, guess what? I also talk about the English language as well. I talk about different types of English, different words, different grammar, all sorts of things. And also, I made a series of lessons called Full English. And here, right now, you are going to see an excerpt from one of those lessons. And then after, yes, we have Mr. Steve coming up in just a few minutes' time. Thank you.
Oh, look at me. I'm really going up in the world today. I'm climbing the ladder of success. I'm heading to the top. You might describe me as a social climber. Let's just hope I don't slide back down to the bottom again, or even worse, fall head first. Hi everybody, and welcome to another full English lesson. I'm really enjoying the view from up here. Can you see me waving to you? I hope so. Here I am once more talking to you from the birthplace of the English language, which is of course England. So without any more dawdling or dilly-dallying, let's get on with today's full English lesson, which will start around about now. If there's one thing I've learned about English, it's that quite often the simplest words have the most meanings. For example, you have the words hot and cold. In its most common sense, the word hot describes something that is of high temperature. It is holding a high degree of heat. It might be dangerous to touch or drink. Don't go near the stove, it's hot. Can you open a window? It's hot in here. The word hot can be used in other ways too. Something that is popular or fashionable can be described as hot. Something that is in high demand might be described as the hottest thing around. Cycling has become the latest hot health routine. This toy is going to be the hottest item in the shops this Christmas. Something that might generate a lot of interest can be described as hot. We have some new hot properties to show you. As an idiom, something might be too hot to handle. This means that the thing in question should be avoided, or at least handled with care. We can't discuss that topic here. It's too hot to handle for us. In a stressful situation where you are under a lot of pressure, we might say that the heat is on. The heat is on for the sales force to reach their targets. You can feel the heat, which means to be involved in a risky or high-stakes situation. An attractive person might be hot. There were some hot models at this year's fashion show. Heat can be used as a verb to describe the action of introducing heat to something. You must heat the soup before serving it. As a slang word, the word heat can mean the police. As part of a phrase, we can use heat. To do something in the heat of the moment means to act in a spontaneous or unprepared way, normally in reaction to something. You do something in the heat of the moment. A stolen item that is being passed around can be described as hot. I wouldn't buy any jewellery from him. It's all hot. A person who often loses their temper can be described as a hothead. The word cold can also be used in many ways. An unwelcoming response might be described as cold. To be underwhelmed by something can often create a cold response. His performance was greeted with cold silence. The feeling of being repulsed or offended by something can be described as cold. You feel upset and put off by what you saw or heard. His humour throughout the evening left me feeling cold. You can give someone a cold stare. You look at them with disapproval and disdain. As an expression, you might give someone the cold shoulder. To shun someone or to choose to ignore a person directly is to give the cold shoulder. He tried to approach me after dinner, but I gave him the cold shoulder. To make something cold, you need to cool it. The word cool can be used to describe a period in which you can change your mind about something. A cooling off period is often allowed so as to give time for a person to consider what they have done. The holiday booking allows you a cooling off period of 14 days. This means that you have 2 weeks in which to change your mind. You might go off the idea. You cool off. The word cool can be used to describe something that creates excitement or is seen as impressive. Something is cool. That's a cool bike you've got there. For younger people, this particular expression might appear old-fashioned and not cool. During a criminal investigation, an inquiry that has no new leads might be described as having gone cold. An unsolved crime that occurred many years ago can be described as a cold case. A cold thing can also be described as chilled. As an idiom, you can chill out or just chill. To relax and unwind is to chill. I think I'll just stay in tonight and chill in front of the television. General negativity from a person can be described as chilly. My new ideas for the next meeting were met with a chilly response. The phrase come in from the cold means to return to a place or group that had previously rejected you. You are welcome back and forgiven. You have come in from the cold. Can you see what I'm doing here? I'm trying to find something to watch on television. Sometimes it is hard to find something good to watch. I often spend many hours trying to find a decent show to watch. I often flick through the channels in the desperate attempt to find something that catches my eye. You flick through the channels. You flip through the channels. You scan up and down the channels. Many years ago, we used to have to get up and go over to the TV to change the channel. These days, we can use the remote control. This item can cause a lot of annoyance and frustration, as it often gets mislaid. Has anyone seen the TV remote? It was here on the sofa earlier, but now it's gone. The TV remote is used to control all the functions of the television set, including the sound level and picture controls. The sound level is called the volume. You can turn up the volume to increase the sound level and turn down the volume if the sound level is too high or too loud. In this case, the word volume simply means amount or quantity. The level is the volume which controls the amount of sound coming from the TV. A person who likes flicking through the TV channels can be described as a channel hopper. If a person watches TV all the time, then we might describe them as a telly addict. Telly is another word for a television set. A television can also be called the goggle box. The word goggle refers to a person's eyes staring at the flickering picture, and box refers to the shape of the TV. Although these days, many TV sets are actually flat and take up very little space. Television sets come in many different screen sizes, from just a few inches to fit on a small desk, right up to the ones that resemble something you might find in a cinema.
And don't forget, there are many, many English lessons on my YouTube channel. They are all there for you to watch as many times as you want.
Hello. Hello, Mr. Duncan. Hello, viewers.
Does he really need an introduction?
Yes.
I don't think you do, actually. Not anymore. Would you like a round of applause?
Go on.
Here he is. Steve's back.
I am, and it didn't seem that long ago since I was last on with you, Mr. Duncan.
No.
When was it? Was it Wednesday or Thursday?
Well, if you remember, I was putting up the Christmas lights And this is something I showed a few moments ago. I'm going to show it again because Mr. Steve last week, almost gave me a heart attack. Sometimes I'm thinking to myself, perhaps Steve is actually trying to do that. So this is what happened last week, a very unusual moment. Watch very carefully. You will see me jump out of my skin because Steve suddenly appears at the window. So take a close look. Watch my reaction as I turn round. And Mr. Steve really just put the willies at me.
Is it ever? Sorry about that. Mr. Steve is actually at the window. There's Mr. Steve. Can you see Mr. Steve? There's Mr. Steve. It would appear that we can't get away from Mr. Steve. Whatever he's getting. Hello, Mr. Steve.
Did I just shock you, Mr. Duncan?
Steve just gave me a big shock then. I wasn't expecting to see Mr. Steve at the window. Yes, you did. You did. You frightened the life out of me then. Are you okay, Steve? Is that
I'm
it?
Fine.
Yes.
I'm well.
You should be working.
I know. I'm going back now.
Get back to work.
Don't want to get told off.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
So we can never get away from Mr. Steve. I'm sorry about that.
We certainly can't. So that is what happened last week.
I like to give you surprises, Mr. Duncan, as you well know.
I've noticed recently, though, you do this quite a lot.
Well, and not intentionally.
I don't know how you do it, but when Steve, I don't know how he does it. I'm sure Mr. Steve has the power of levitation. I'm sure Mr. Steve can actually float above the ground.
I was just taking a break from work. The window was shut, so you wouldn't have seen me.
No. But I thought,
I'll go and see what Mr. Duncan's doing.
Yeah.
I looked out of the window, and at that moment, you turned round.
I know,
I hadn't been there for long.
No, but this happens in the house as well. I'm upstairs or downstairs, and then suddenly Mr. Steve will just appear.
Ah.
Without any sound.
Well,
maybe it's because you're wearing your soft slippers.
My soft slippers, you see.
Ooh.
Look at the soles on those.
Those are disgusting. Oh my God!
They're very soft soles.
Take that away. I think
they don't smell at all.
I think we found out where coronavirus is coming from.
They're very. I've had these for years. I wore them on stage a few years ago. They were incredibly cheap. Moccasins, they're called, but they're incredibly comfortable. But they do have a very soft sole,
so I
can creep around the house without Mr. Duncan knowing.
A bit like you. You have a very soft sole.
We've got somebody new, Mariam from Georgia.
Hello, Mariam in Georgia. Can I say hello to you? And of course, if it is your first time, I will give you a special warm welcome with a round of applause.
Hope we haven't embarrassed you, Mariam, but it's nice to have new viewers.
Yes.
Also, you said that you were learning a lot, so that's good to know.
So when you woke up this morning, I bet you didn't realise that you were going to get a round of applause from a couple of weirdos on the internet. I bet you didn't think that this morning when you woke up. Isn't life wonderful how things can happen suddenly? I mentioned something earlier, Steve. Many years ago, in some of my jobs, many of the jobs that I've done, quite often I would work for a woman.
A woman boss.
A woman boss, yes, a female boss. Now, some men, I'm sure that you've experienced this in your life as well as you've moved around. Some men don't like working for women. They find it, I suppose the word is emasculating. They feel as if it takes away their masculinity. They are no longer men. So some men don't like that. But I have to be honest. I have so many fond memories of working with my female bosses. They would sometimes do very little work. Sometimes we would all go into the staff room and they would bring, shall I just say, alcoholic drinks into work.
Don't think that's allowed anymore, Mr. Duncan.
I'm sure it still goes on.
Well, I've had lots of female bosses in my time.
Hmm.
I mean, many years ago, for example, I started working in sales. I've been in sales for over 30 years. So I started doing that 30 years ago, more than 30 years ago.
Okay.
And the company I worked for then wouldn't employ women. Full stop.
Can you believe that?
It was many years before they employed. They just didn't like women working for them. But they were a very traditionalist company. But the company I'm working for now is a French company.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very liberal.
Mm.
And I've worked for them for 24 years. And I've had probably my favourite ever boss was female.
Mm.
Definitely.
I think you can have more of a laugh. I think you can have more fun. And you know, when your job is getting on top of you, you've had too much of the job. I'm sure you know how that feels, Steve. Hint, hint. So, yeah, I think it's great. I think female bosses are very capable of having fun. I think a male boss has to keep his authority, doesn't he? So I think a male boss or a man who is in charge, he is less likely to lower his professionalism. So I quite like it. I have no problem with that. I don't want to sound woke, but I do think it's important to have women and men working in the same place. And so what if a woman is a boss? It doesn't really matter to me. In fact, some of my wonderful memories, my most cherished memories of working years ago was working with women. I worked with women virtually all the time.
Did they think of you as one of the girls, Mr. Duncan?
Maybe. That might be a very fair point. Yes. No, that's OK, Steve. I think you're right.
I'm only joking. I mean, the important thing, it doesn't matter who you're working for, who your boss is. It's the person that matters.
Yes.
Not whether they're male, female or whatever.
But
it doesn't matter.
But I don't agree with that situation where they'd say they'd prefer a man over a woman. I think men and women are equally as capable of doing things well, but also equally as capable of doing things badly. You see?
It's all about the person. And in the UK now, there's no, I don't think any man would have a problem working for a woman now. 30 years ago, yes, but now things have changed dramatically. Mm. There are many women in high-powered jobs. We've had a woman prime minister.
Yes, here. And very soon a vice president in the United States, a female.
Yeah, so, I mean,
female.
You know, it's not an issue in the UK anymore. And certainly you couldn't mouth any objections because there are laws in place to protect people of all sexes and all categories, shall we say.
Categories.
Leave it at that. We have very strong equality laws in this country.
All categories of human beings are welcome.
Yes. Exactly.
I like
it's
that.
All about the person.
Anyway.
And are they good at the job?
Hey, we have some fun in the kitchen coming up.
Yes, we do.
And I thought it would be interesting to give a little clue. But first of all, can I show today's mystery object again? We had a mystery object earlier, so I'm going to show it again. See if Mr. Steve knows. Here it is, coming on the screen now, Steve. There it is. There is today's mystery object.
Well.
Now, I know what Mr. Steve is going to say. I know what you're going to say before you say it.
Is it an ashtray?
Oh, OK. No. I thought you were going to say, you know, if you are a man in hospital and you need to go for a wee-wee.
Yes, they're not made of metal.
This looks very similar, doesn't it, to the thing that they give you if you are in bed and you are a male, but you can't go to the toilet. So you have to put your pee-pee in there and then you fill this part up.
I don't, Mr. Duncan.
But it isn't that.
That obviously could not possibly be that.
It isn't that. But they did used to be metal.
Yes, they probably were in the old days.
The old days, years ago, they used to be metal.
Because that would be easier to sterilise and keep clean and wouldn't break.
Yes. So if you wanted a number one, if you wanted a wee-wee, you might use one of those. But this is not that.
Sergio says a chamber pot.
It is not.
That's a good word, chamber pot.
Yes.
A chamber pot is literally traditionally it'd be made of porcelain.
Yeah.
That you would keep under your bed and use to go to the toilet if you needed to do so in the night, in the days before we had flushing toilets in our homes.
Well, a lot of people had flushing toilets, but the problem is, Steve, they were outside.
Yes.
My nan and granddad used to have an outdoor toilet. And
so did mine.
And so when I went to stay with my gran and grandpa, they would actually have a little pot under the bed where I slept.
Yes.
So if I needed a wee-wee in the night, I could just hop out of bed. But I didn't like to stand up doing it. So what I used to do, I used to kneel down next to the chamber pot.
I don't know, Mr. Duncan.
So I used to do a wee-wee whilst kneeling down because I didn't like to stand up because it would make too much noise. And I didn't want anyone else in the house to know that I was having a wee-wee, you see. So that gives you an idea of what kind of child I was.
Too much information, Mr. Duncan.
It's interesting. But we don't have them anymore. I just wee out the window.
Tomek makes an interesting point, or just in the bed. Tomek makes an interesting point. If a female boss makes you feel emasculated, it means that you are insecure.
Hmm.
Good point.
Yes. Well, I think many men are insecure. I think so.
I think women are as well.
Yes, I think so. But I mean, in that situation where it is someone of the opposite gender in charge, I think it can bring about insecurity. Maybe not prejudice. But that could also be part of the equation, you see. So, yes, I think it could be possible.
Lewis says, is it an engine component?
It does look like it. What part of an engine do you think that might be, Steve?
Another look. Is that some kind of, you know, on the pipe that's coming out?
Yes.
Here. Is that some kind of leather or cloth covering or something?
It is actually covered with leather. You are right in that respect. But there is a reason for that. There is a reason for that. Can you imagine what the reason might be?
If you tell me what this is, Mr. Duncan, will I know? Have I ever seen one before?
You haven't. In fact, these are very common in Korea. So you might find them quite often in South Korea. These are used quite often for a certain thing. And yes, it does involve heat.
Marietta says, is it the end part or the last part of an exhaust pipe?
Yes, it does look like part of a car.
It does.
But in fact, it isn't. We've had a correct answer. So it is not a urine bottle for pee-peeing into. It is not one of those. I'll give the answer in a moment, actually. We won't keep this going too long.
Giovanni says, is it something to smoke opium?
Oh, no.
It does look like does look like something to do with drugs.
It is nothing illegal.
Okay.
Nothing illegal. We would not do that here on this lovely family-friendly show.
Jimmy says, it reminds you of a Chinese hot pot.
Yes, it is. It is something that has heat. So that is very close. I will give you the answer right now. I'm going to give you the answer because we have lots of other things. We're going in the kitchen in a moment, Steve. And then after that, we have the sentence game. So many things to talk about.
Will
today.
We get round to the sentence game today before 4:45?
It's unlikely.
Exactly. Because there's always lots to talk about. And it's wonderful that you're all putting your comments down. We love the feedback. Okay. Please don't stop.
Nope.
Unfortunately, we can't read them all out. I will say that because sometimes it's too quick. So apologies if we don't read everybody's comment out.
So the answer to the mystery object before we start cooking in the kitchen is, and this is quite surprising, something I've never seen before, but now I know what it is. It is a
coffee roaster. Well, has somebody got that?
Yes, I know. I had one correct answer. A Percello.
Percello.
Congratulations. Yes, it is a coffee roaster. So what you do is you put the coffee in there and heat it up and it will roast. And then out of here, Steve, the thing here, you pour the coffee beans out. So they go in there unroasted and they come out that end roasted. Interesting. So I've never seen one of these before, but apparently they are very common in Korea. people use them to roast their coffee beans.
Percello or Percello, we're not sure how to pronounce your name, so apologies. You were right.
Yes.
How big is it, Mr. Duncan? Because we can't get an idea of the size.
It is quite large. So you can imagine putting lots of coffee beans in there, and then they roast on a flame or on a heat, and as they're roasting, they are ready to come out of there.
Oh,
so it's in and out.
So how big is it? That much across?
It's
how
about
much
the size
say?
Of a small frying pan.
Ah, so right. I thought it was quite small.
Mm.
But there we go.
Yes. It's good though. Good.
I can see that working.
Yes. I think it's a good idea, actually. It's quite a neat invention.
Yes, and obviously it's got that leather covering over it so that you don't burn your hands.
That's it, because you've got to grab that end to turn it over, to twist it, so that the coffee beans will come out. So there it is. There it is. That is what the mystery object actually was.
See, we wouldn't know that because we don't roast our own beans. I don't think anybody does that in this country.
But it did look a little bit like something from a hospital.
It did. But immediately I thought, well, that wouldn't work as a urinal collecting device because it would just pour out everywhere. You know. But yes, and yeah, well, obviously it would have accommodated all sizes as well.
Okay, then. That's interesting. So we will be taking a break right now. We are going to take a break, in fact, because we're going into the kitchen. I spent all night doing this. I've edited this video. It took me all night. I went to bed at 4:30 this morning.
Correct.
Because of this video. So I hope you enjoy it, and I hope it was worth it. We're going into the kitchen, but I suppose the big question is, Steve, what are we going to make?
Well, there was a clue in the lesson on Thursday.
Yes, there is a big clue coming up.
Yes.
In fact, I've given a couple of clues already today. So what is it? Find out right now. Okay, here we are once again. It's Saturday night and we are busy in the kitchen. My name is Mr. Duncan, and coming up in a moment, Mr. Steve. Tonight we are going to cook something rather delicious. In fact, it is something we mentioned a couple of days ago on our live stream. What could it be? Let's find out with the man himself. Here he comes. It's Mr. Steve!
Hello, everybody! Welcome to the Cookery Channel. And I'm going to make some cauliflower cheese.
A couple of days ago, we actually showed the cauliflower, didn't we? On the live stream.
And what a beauty it is, too. A beautiful cauliflower. What we're going to do is cut it up, boil it in some water, and then meanwhile, I'm going to make some cheese sauce so that we can pour that over the top of it when it's cooked and put it in the oven along with, which reminds me, Mr. Duncan, we need to put in our lamb shanks.
Yes.
Because they are going to take approximately 45 minutes to cook. So in this goes, Mr. Duncan.
The whole meal we're having tonight is lamb shank, potatoes, sweet potatoes, and also this particular thing, which is cauliflower cheese.
The potatoes and the sweet potatoes are already in this saucepan, which I am now going to place on the stove. I've worked out before that you need to start everything cooking at the same time, and then everything will be ready together, because that's always the skill which you need as a chef, as a cook, so that everything is ready at the same time, your vegetables, your meat, your sauces, because you don't want to be waiting 10 minutes for the main course to cook in the oven and the vegetables aren't ready, or the other way around, as we say.
So when we talk about courses, we are talking about each individual meal. So some people have more than one course. You might have one course, maybe just one meal. If you have, say, three courses, then it means you are having maybe something to start with, maybe something as a main meal, and then something afterwards as dessert.
Right, so let's start cutting this little beast up. So I'm just going to cut off the florets. These are called florets. Right, so we're cutting up the cauliflower. Make little incisions, we put cross incisions on the stalk.
Why?
Because it cooks quicker, because otherwise you will cook this bit too quickly. Yes. And that will still be hard.
So the outside will be soft, but the inside will be too hard.
That's it. And we don't want to overcook the outside. So that's going in the saucepan. Being very careful, of course, not to chop it into my fingers.
Yes. One of the most important things when you're using a knife, you must not chop your fingers off. For those who have just tuned in, yes, we are once more in the kitchen. We are doing something else. Tonight we are making, well, we are having a full meal. However, Mr. Steve is going to make some of his delicious cauliflower cheese.
So I'm going to, I've got half a pint of milk, which is approximately 300 mils.
So when we say mils, we mean what? Millilitres?
Millilitres, about a third of a litre, just under that. So I should put the milk on. I'm going to use corn flour to thicken the sauce, because it's much more reliable than using normal wheat flour. You don't get lumps with corn flour. So I'm going to mix some into what's left of some of the milk in here. That's too much, I think. So I want to make a nice little mix before I add the boiling water into it. Now, so how much do I need, Mr.
Duncan? It's almost like a paste.
So in we go with the corn flour. You can't go wrong with corn flour if you are making a sauce that you want to thicken, because it's almost impossible to get lumps with corn flour. It's just wonderful. So I've just mixed that in with some of the milk that's left in there, and then I'm going to pour the hot milk on top, and it will thicken almost immediately. While we're waiting for the milk to boil, I can cut up the cheese that's going to go in there. And we need 2 to 4 ounces, which is 50 to 100 grams. Obviously, if it says 2 to 4, we're going to put in 4. Because that makes for a much more tasty sauce. I think that's approximately right. Oh, it's nowhere near, Mr. Duncan.
We need more than that.
We need more than that.
More cheese.
More cheese.
More.
There we go.
More cheese. We want more.
More ounces.
More. More cheese.
So the milk, as you can see, is rapidly coming to the boil.
Oh, yes.
So we want a bit of pepper in there. We want to spice up the white sauce a little. So I'll add some pepper, and I'll also add a little bit of mustard. Now, this is ready-made mustard, but you could add some mustard powder, about half a teaspoon. Where's my wooden spoon gone, Mr. Duncan? I had a wooden spoon, it's gone. Where has it gone? Oh. I don't know what that's doing there. There's my wooden spoon. Stir it rapidly. And it hasn't been quite hot enough to thicken it. So we put it back into the saucepan. It's all on the go here, Mr. Duncan. Let me put a lid on that. And if you say in English, you're going to put a lid on that. What does it mean, Mr. Duncan?
It means you are going to maybe stop something from being talked about, or maybe put an end to something. You can put a lid on something as a way of saying, I'm going to bring this to an end. I'm not going to allow anyone to talk about this thing or to allow it to continue any longer.
Yes.
I am going to put a lid on it.
So look at that. That's thickened up nicely.
Ooh, lovely.
And we want it nice and thick, because we don't want a runny sauce on the cauliflower.
No.
I will now add the cheese. We don't want the cheese to go into a really hot sauce. We don't want the cheese to cook, really.
No. So you just want it to go soft, but not actually cook.
I probably should have grated this cheese. It would have made it a little easier, but it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. The cheese is now going in, and look at that. Oh my goodness, I can't wait to eat this.
The cauliflower doesn't take long to cook. Then the cheese sauce will be ready. I'm going to put a little pinch of chili powder in here as well. Now, Mr. Duncan didn't see me do this last time, only because it'll just give it a little extra spice, but I'm hardly going to put anything in because I don't want it to overpower the cheese sauce. The cauliflower has come to the boil. Your lens might be steaming up, Mr. Duncan. It gets very frantic in the kitchen, as any mother who cooks. Being sexist there, because fathers cook as well. I need to check on the lamb shanks now. Yes, they're cooking away nicely, Mr. Duncan.
So there is something that still needs to be done with this. So what you're going to do eventually is put the cauliflower on a tray or in a container, and then Steve is going to pour the cheese sauce over the top of the cauliflower, and then all of that will go in the oven. So there it is. There is the dish that Mr. Steve is going to actually put the cauliflower and also the cheese onto. So that is where it's all going to happen. That is where all the action is going to take place, on that little glass dish.
C'est magnifique. Oh, but I could just drink that down, Mr. Duncan. It's almost like fondue.
Ah, yes. Do you know what, Steve? I've never tried fondue.
I have.
I've never tried it. So how's the cauliflower coming along? The
cauliflower is now ready. Now, the thing with cauliflower is it holds a lot of water when it's cooking. So it takes a while to get rid of all the water. So now I'm going to put it into the dish, ready for the white sauce to be poured on.
Oh, look at that. Steaming hot cauliflower. So now the cauliflower is ready to have the cheese sauce poured over it. So just to show how stressful cooking can be sometimes, Mr. Steve has decided to have some liquid refreshment. Otherwise known as alcohol.
Ah, we probably should be drinking red wine, because that would go better with the meal and it would make us look sophisticated. But we're not sophisticated, so we're going to drink beer. Well, I am.
Oh, speak for yourself.
Mm. Well, anyway, let's get this cauliflower cheese on, shall we?
I think Steve was going to swear then. Were you going to swear then?
Right, we just pour the cheese on.
Look at that.
And of course, the yellow colour is caused by the mustard. Right, we want to cover all the cauliflower.
Steve, can I lick my finger from that saucepan?
You may.
Oh.
You may. That's ready.
Look at that. As Mr. Steve slowly gets drunk.
I'm going to put this in the oven, Mr. Duncan. And this will be ready in about 15 minutes.
I think Steve just said he's going to put this in the oven. Oh, I see. So it goes on the bottom. Look at that! The lamb shank. Can I just say, we didn't run around the field chasing the farmer's sheep or lambs, okay? Can we just be clear on that? Thank you very much.
The potatoes are cooked, Mr. Duncan.
So it would appear that the potatoes are now cooked.
They're cooked. So I will drain the potatoes.
So now Mr. Steve is draining away the water that was being used to boil the potatoes. So now we are going to make some mashed potatoes. Ooh, very nice. I must admit, I'm rather excited by this.
I'm going to add a good splodge of butter.
Oh yes.
Because Mr. Duncan likes butter in his mashed potatoes. We also know how Mr. Duncan loves mashed potatoes.
I love potatoes anyway.
So I'm just going to heat that slightly.
Look what I've got here. Look what I've got here. I've got the spoon with some of the cheese sauce. Oh my goodness. That is delicious.
Naughty, Mr. Duncan. Right, let's mash the potatoes. This is hard work.
We could do a little song. Mr. Steve is mashing the potatoes to a pulp. Mr. Steve is mashing. He's making quite. Now, there isn't a word that rhymes with pulp.
It's quite hard work mashing potatoes.
Yeah.
And I'd like to give exercise to my left arm.
What about your right arm?
We're losing it, Mr. Duncan. It's always very difficult to keep the potato in. It's very messy mashing potatoes, don't you think?
I've noticed.
This is very gassy, beer, but it's doing the trick.
It's a bit like you, very gassy.
Do you know, with these saucepans that we've got, Mr. Duncan, I never get the right lid for the saucepan. If you've got a set of saucepans, it's always very difficult to work out just from looking which lid fits.
I can smell burning, Steve.
I think it's just, I don't know why it's like boiling over.
Because
I've only got it on low, Mr. Duncan. It's going mad. Let's see if the peas are cooked. I don't like overcooked peas. Now, if there's one thing I don't like, it's overcooked peas.
What are you trying to do? So there it is. The cauliflower cheese is ready to go with our delicious meal of lamb shank, potatoes, sweet potatoes, and also garden peas as well. Anyway, we're going to sit down and enjoy our meal now, and I will return you back to the studio. Thank you, Mr. Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Duncan.
Mr. Steve will now go into the dining room. He will lie down on the floor where he will slowly sober up. Shall I do it again? So there it was. I hope you enjoyed that. We were in the kitchen last night. We were making our evening dinner and we had cauliflower cheese, and there it is on the screen right now. And can I just say, Mr. Steve, it was absolutely delicious. Oh, now I'm wondering if there is anyone out there who is going to try and make some cauliflower cheese.
Not at the moment. They've got to watch us first.
Yes, don't do it yet.
We should have given a warning before that, before we showed that clip, Mr. Duncan, to all vegetarians out there, a warning that they might see meat cooking, parts of dead animals cooking. So we do apologise if you're vegetarian. I mean, we don't eat much meat, but when we do, we enjoy it.
If animals insist on being delicious, then what can we do about it?
People are getting very hungry, Mr. Duncan. Yeah. Very hungry, but Tomek's all right because his wife is cooking.
Oh, good.
At the moment. So what's she cooking, Tomek? We'd like to know.
What is your wife doing in the kitchen?
Yes, Valentina says that she liked my apron, but it didn't match with the shirt. Now, I went to a lot of effort to look smart yesterday.
Can I just say, it looked like you were wearing pyjamas.
I went to a lot of effort. I probably should have worn a contrast.
I thought you were going to say a condom.
All you ever think about, Mr. Duncan.
I thought
a contrast. I should have had maybe a lighter coloured shirt.
Why would you want
underneath?
Why would you want to wear a condom in the kitchen? I don't know.
I never said that, Mr. Duncan. That was your dirty mind.
I suppose it depends if you were
a contrast.
Maybe you were stirring your soup.
Two things that look different against each other.
I don't know.
But Mr. Duncan looked a complete scruff. At least I made some kind of effort.
I look lovely with my lovely beard in the fluorescent light. It's the one thing I will say definitely, the lighting in the kitchen is not great because we have one of those horrible long fluorescent tubes. And as you know, if you are a photographer or a filmmaker like me, you will know that fluorescent light is awful for filming. It really is.
Alessandra says, I cook cauliflowers almost every day.
Really?
Yes. So that's fantastic. And Sergio says he likes cauliflower with eggs.
Oh, okay then.
Roasted cauliflower with eggs.
Oh.
That would be quite a complete meal, really. That would be, you've got the vegetables and you've got protein. That's quite a healthy meal.
Mm.
Somebody's asked, why have I got a pen in my hand? It's because I'm looking at the live chat. And so that I don't forget, I'm writing things down about the live chat.
It also gives Mr. Steve something to play with in his hand.
And if I keep putting it down, it makes a noise, and that annoys Mr. Duncan.
Yes. You do like making lots of noise.
Lewis's wife makes a cauliflower with bechamel sauce.
Oh.
Which is, I think that's like a runnier sauce.
Oh, I see.
It's a bit runnier, I think, and it's got sort of onions in it. And a few vegetables and things like that. It's very, very French,
yes.
I would say.
One of the things I did enjoy last night was watching the sauce and the cheese mixed together. The cheese was melting. We didn't mention it in the video, but we did mention it last night whilst recording that there is a thing called fondue. Now, I have never, this is true, I've never tried fondue ever, which is basically melted cheese. I believe the word itself means melted in French. So it does originate in French, and melted cheese, fondue. But I've never tried it.
Nisar says cauliflower is a vegetable which in India comes in the winter months.
Oh, okay.
And that's the same here.
Mm.
Because it grows during, I think, the summer period, and then it's ready when winter comes along.
Yes.
And when you think lots of vegetables are normally, they grow and you pick them in the summer.
Yes.
Like peas, things like that, beans. But things like cauliflower,
mm-hmm,
and broccoli tend to be ready at the end of the growing season. So
yes,
they're ready for winter. And Brussels sprouts, because they can withstand the cold temperatures and
yes,
stay on the plant.
They are very hardy.
Yes, which is good because it means you get some vegetable all year round in all the different seasons. I mean, you couldn't grow a lettuce in winter. You have to grow a lettuce in favourable conditions, whereas cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, broccoli can withstand a frost. And in fact, they taste better afterwards. People have asked, what was I doing with the peas?
Yes.
Well,
Mr. Steve was stabbing the peas for a very long time.
I was just trying to get one on the end of the knife.
Oh, I see.
And Mr. Duncan thought he'd have a bit of fun with that.
Yes, it did go on for a very long time, but then that might have been my editing, you see.
Mary Alba says, chocolate fondue.
I've never tried. Now, there are places you can go to, Steve. There are restaurants, and they have that the chocolate waterfall. And all of the chocolate just falls down the side of this never-ending flow.
That's a bit different.
And you can put things inside and eat it. But
I have had chocolate fondue, Mr. Duncan.
Really?
Yes, it's melted. And you get sweet things like marshmallows on a fork, soft marshmallows.
Stop it.
And you put them in and, ooh.
Oh, my goodness. I tell you something. I'm starting to feel very hungry. So this might be a regular thing. We might do something every week where we're doing something in the kitchen. Do you like it? Would you like to see more of it or maybe less of it?
Mojo says IPA beer. Yes. Yes, I like that particular. It's not a brand. It's a particular type of beer.
Okay.
A class of beer. India Pacific. beer, it's called, I've always liked that. So yes, fondue is fantastic. It's usually made of melted Fortina cheese. Ooh. And some people have asked, what cheese did we put in the cauliflower cheese? It was a British cheese called cheddar, which is a hard cheese with a strong flavour.
Yes, a very mature cheddar. It has to be strong cheese, yes, or else you don't get the flavour. Anyway, Steve, we were looking at cauliflowers. Would you like to see... Would you like five interesting facts all about the cauliflower?
No.
Well, tough, because that's what we're doing now. So, just for today, we have five interesting facts about the cauliflower. Five fun facts concerning the vegetable we were cooking today. Well, in fact, there were two vegetables. There was one cooking it and one being cooked.
I do these live streams for nothing.
Here we go then. Five fun facts, because you know what's happening now, where we're going to be late. We're going to be late with the sentence game. I'm going to get complaints. I can feel them coming now. I can sense lots of angry people typing on their keyboards saying, Mr. Duncan, you stupid idiot, where is the sentence game? So five interesting fun facts about the cauliflower. Did you know that the cauliflower is a type of cabbage?
Yes.
No, you didn't. Because last night you said you didn't know what it was. What it actually was.
Well, the leaves on the outside that we don't eat in the cauliflower, you probably saw me tearing off the outer leaves.
Yes.
They look a bit like cabbage. You probably can eat them.
Yes. But don't, just in case. So that's the first one. The cauliflower is a type of cabbage. That's very interesting.
Very interesting, Mr. Duncan.
Very interesting indeed. Another one. OK, let's have a look at another one, if I can get it to come up. Here we go. It takes a while.
Faster.
It's all mechanical, you see. We have everything is steam powered here, unfortunately.
Right.
Oh, the centre. The white centre is really a flower head, albeit immature.
Wow.
Did you know that? So it is actually a flower. So you imagine a flower when it's young, before it actually opens out.
Right.
So the actual centre, the white part of a cauliflower, is actually the flower head. So it is actually part of a flower, but it's the immature flower.
So I wonder what it would look like if you let it grow and develop into a proper flower.
Yes. Well, I would imagine, like anything, it will eventually go to seed. So it might become a flower. It might grow in a certain way. So you do often see vegetables that have been left in the ground too long, and we will often say that they have gone to seed. So it means you can't use them anymore for cooking because they've gone too far. They are too mature.
Well, broccoli does that. If you get an old piece of broccoli, it looks like it's gone off a bit. You can sort of see small little flower heads in amongst it. So that must be similar.
So the white of a cauliflower is actually a flower head.
I didn't know that.
There we go. Here's another one. Oh, okay then. In English, the name cauliflower derives from the word col. So it's actually an old English word, which literally means cabbage.
Right, okay.
So that's the reason why we say cauliflower. So it used to be col flower, flower of the cabbage, you see? So it all works, right. You see? It all works.
Interesting facts, Mr. Duncan.
In English, the name cauliflower derives from the word col, which means cabbage. It is an English word. There are, of course, other derivations as well in other languages before anyone says...
Not that we use that word anymore.
No, well, it's archaic.
It's an old word.
So we don't actually use the word col anymore, even though it remains in the word cauliflower. Yes, you see, you're actually learning something today with me. Here's another one, Steve. The cauliflower belongs to a range of vegetable known as brassica. which is related to Swedes and also mustard, and I believe rapeseed as well, if I'm not mistaken. So the cauliflower belongs to a range of vegetables known as brassica. So brassica.
Does that include
cabbages?
Yes.
And I think maybe, please don't quote me, but maybe Brussels sprouts.
Yes, Brussels sprouts are in there, and probably broccoli as well. Mm.
So they all have a very distinct appearance.
Now, yes. Oh, one more fact, Mr. Duncan.
One more fact. I know Steve is very eager to move on. Here we go. And this is something that we mentioned last night, but unfortunately I edited Mr. Steve's moment out.
No, you did.
Oh, did you?
Yes, you did mention that.
You did mention it. Yes, that's it. I remember it around about 3 o'clock this morning. I was editing all of that. And I didn't go to bed until 4:30 this morning because of that video. Yes, the fifth fun fact about the cauliflower, the small white segments of the cauliflower are called florets. Florets, small flowers. So florette means a tiny flower. Quite often in French you will say something that is small. It will often end with et. So something that is small, maybe a small or short piece of music, might be a minuet. Is that a good example?
I think so, yes. Definitely.
So a minuet is literally something that lasts for around a minute. A minuet, a small, short time, or maybe a short piece of classical music. So there it was. That was it. Did you enjoy that, Steve?
No, it's all right.
Five interesting fun facts about our friend, the humble cauliflower. Mr. Steve wants to talk about the lamb shanks.
Only because Giovanni Romano...
Oh, hello, Giovanni.
..says, what is the recipe for the lamb shank? Well...
Oh, dear.
We cheated a bit there.
We did?
We cheated because I didn't make the sauce for the lamb shank. It was pre-packaged, and you just take it out of its plastic package... Put it into a dish and put it in the oven. Because if you make lamb shank from the raw lamb, you have to cook it for about 3 or 4 hours.
Yes, to make it tender.
Yes. So the sauce and everything came with it. It was a mint sauce. Mint. It's very popular to have mint with lamb in the UK. But a sweet mint sauce with lots of fat in there because... Lamb is a very fatty meat. It's a lovely sauce that comes with this.
Yes, actually, it is shop bought. So what we often say, if we buy something that's pre-made, we will often say it's shop bought. Shop bought. So it's actually almost like a phrase that often people use, especially if we are trying to embarrass someone. So maybe you go to your friend's house and they make a lovely meal. and whilst eating it, you will wonder... to yourself whether they made it fresh or if they bought it from the shop, you see. So shop bought. So yes, our lamb shank was not fresh. We didn't prepare it ourselves. It was from the shop. It was shop bought.
Marietta says that in some parts of northern Spain, we used to eat cauliflower with cod on Christmas Eve. It was like a tradition then, which is very interesting. And Christina says cauliflower is rich in minerals that are essential for bowel health.
Ooh.
And you could do with a bit of that, couldn't you, Mr. Duncan?
No,
a bit of bowel health.
No, I think maybe you're talking about yourself there, Steve.
It contains vitamin C and folic acid, which is a B vitamin.
Okay.
And antioxidants and anti-inflammatory. Mm. So all vegetables are good for us, aren't they? We need to eat. In the UK, we've been told to eat 5 portions of fruit and vegetables a day as a minimum, preferably 10.
Yes, they think now you have to eat 10 every day.
Yes.
I mean, if you ate 10 varieties of fruit and vegetable every day, you'd be sitting on the toilet for half of the day. just getting rid of it.
Also in Rome, they have cod with fish on Christmas Eve. Cod with the broccoli on Christmas Eve.
Oh, okay, I've never heard of that before.
Tomek, I think it was Tomek, or was it? I think it was Tomek that says he's got a tap in his kitchen that just has chocolate comes out of it all the time.
Wow.
Yes, that I like the sound of that. Sergio, it was Sergio that said that.
Sergio, you've just
has a tap with chocolate.
Sergio, you've just blown my mind.
Yes.
That, yeah. Instead of water, you could just turn on the tap and imagine that just chocolate would come out. Would it be warm or cold though? It would have to be warm chocolate, wouldn't it?
I think so.
Imagine that. Imagine if you could just turn on the tap and all of this beautiful brown stuff would come out. Actually, sometimes our water does look like that. Come to think of it, Steve.
Valentina's going, but she wants to know, are you going to do a live stream in the week? If you do, can you let everybody know?
I normally put a notification, but of course not many people get the notifications because of YouTube. It's not my fault, but I try my best. I might be, yes, we will see what happens because we have a lot of very bad weather next week coming. We've had some big storms last night, for example, a lot of stormy weather, I think. We are going to play the sentence game because, well, I was trying to do it earlier, but unfortunately we couldn't, you see.
Why not?
Well, because, well, first of all, we were in the kitchen cooking, and then we were just talking, weren't we?
Look at that. Nisar says, cauliflower is known as gobi in India.
Gobi. Yes.
Yes.
Well, yes, there is an Indian dish that comes with cauliflower in Indian food.
Well, we have it here.
Yes.
Aloo gobi.
Yes. So aloo gobi is, I think it's spicy, but also I think it's got lots of oil.
Yes, it's spicy cauliflower. Mm. Has it got potato in it as well?
Maybe.
Aloo gobi, or is that something else? That's my favourite. I love Indian spices in vegetables, particularly potatoes.
Yes.
Potatoes is something else. I can't remember the name for Indian potatoes. It's got a different name.
Many people mentioned the garlic as well earlier. So, yes, you can have garlic with cauliflower. You can have garlic with, I suppose, broccoli as well. Very popular in Chinese cuisine.
Palmyra says in Lithuania there was a revolution called the cauliflower revolution because the prices of cauliflowers were too high.
Oh, okay.
She says that's true. Wow, imagine that. That would have been a fun fact, Mr. Duncan.
Yes.
That there was a revolution due to the high price of cauliflower.
It wouldn't have been fun if you were involved, though.
No. How many people died, I wonder? Giovanni says, my first appearance this week, it could be my preferred vegetable, I think, now.
Oh.
Yes. What is come on, Nisar, tell us. What do you call a potato dish in India? Spicy potato dish.
Mm.
Can't remember the name of it.
Potatoes do appear quite often in Indian cooking.
Oh, it's gorgeous.
Yes, very nice.
I often have that as a starter.
Oh, we were talking about cauliflower. There is a word or a sentence that relates to cauliflower if you play a certain sport.
Yes.
Ah.
Ah, well done, Mr. Duncan.
Yes. So there is actually an expression. Have you ever heard of cauliflower ear? Cauliflower ear is when the ear of a sports player is damaged repeatedly and it never has a chance to heal properly, so the ear becomes swollen and it never heals properly, so all of the skin and all of the shape of the ear becomes distorted, and they call it cauliflower ear. Quite often people who play rough sports like rugby or boxing.
Particularly, it's associated with rugby in this country because they get their ears pulled and damaged a lot, and it takes on the appearance of a cauliflower.
Yes,
well, swollen and big and horrible.
The ears are quite vulnerable. Do you remember years ago when I think it was Mike Tyson? He actually bit part of his opponent's ear off. I thought you were
only hungry.
I thought you were only supposed to punch, not bite people's body parts. Ooh, that could have been very nasty, if you get my meaning. So we play the sentence game,
yes.
Steve. The sentence game. Would you like to play the sentence game? Would you like to play it with me? Let's do it right
now.
That's nice. I was thinking to myself, we should play the sentence game, definitely. Let's play the sentence game. Lots of people like to play along. You could play along at home if you want. You don't have to get involved, but you can if you want. It's up to you. We are playing the sentence game with random words. So
nothing to do with cauliflowers.
Nothing to do with cauliflowers. Okay. Nothing to do with vegetables. Nothing to do with food, as far as I can tell, anyway. So here we go, the sentence game. I'm going to show you a sentence. There are words missing. I will give you some clues. There are some clues, such as what the missing words begin with, the letters, and also how many words each missing word has, or how many letters each missing word had. I made such a good job of that, didn't I? I did a really good job of introducing that.
You'll soon catch on.
I'm getting better. It's only taken me 14 years. So here we go then. Here's the first sentence game. If you don't know the name of the game or how to play it, well, watch and you will find out. Here we go. Today's first sentence game, Steve.
Ooh. We must something beginning
now.
With L. Five letters. If we are to something beginning with B, four letters. The, something beginning with R, four letters.
We must something now if we are to something the something. L, five letters. B, four letters. And R, four. R, four. That doesn't mean the R rate, by the way. If you had an R rate of four, that wouldn't be very good. I think half of your country would vanish overnight.
God, all these different recipes. Marusk says, or Maruz, cauliflower with butter and breadcrumbs is common in Poland.
Can I come to Poland now and have some breadcrumb cauliflower? I like the sound of that, Steve.
Rosa says, don't I put salt in the mashed potatoes? No.
Ooh, no.
Well, I'd like to, but it would give it a bit more flavour, but... Mm. The salt is also, you see, British food doesn't contain very much salt.
Mm.
People often say that British food is bland.
Mm.
Bland means it hasn't got very much flavour.
No taste.
Because we don't put salt in or very much salt in our food because it's just, we just don't do that. Salt does give flavour, but it also makes you very thirsty and possibly is not good for your health. So I don't tend to add salt in. If we had guests, I would say there's no salt in the food, but if you want to add it, then there will be a little salt pot on the table and you can add it in that way. And in fact, when I've cooked for some of my friends who aren't from the UK, from other countries, I've got friends from the Caribbean, friends from all parts of the world, and if I've cooked for them in the past, they just pour on lots of salt onto whatever I cook because they say it hasn't got enough flavour, enough salt.
Yes.
But
you will find that salt is used a lot in cooking generally, but that the amounts do vary. But of course, nowadays, a lot of food is flavoured with salt, especially processed food.
Yes.
You will find that there is a lot of salt. I try not to have too much salt in my diet. It's not good for your blood pressure. It's also not good generally for your health anyway, because your body has to process salt, and too much can put a strain on your body. So we are playing the sentence game, Steve.
Anna says that Tomek's got it already.
Oh, really?
There's
a surprise.
I'm just trying to look back because we've forgotten about the sentence game.
You forgot.
Yes.
He forgot.
Ricardo says, oh, no, sorry. Soundhraya, sorry, KS, says the first word could be leave. Ricardo says it could be leave.
That's not bad. Leave.
Anna says it could be leave.
Track is very close, but yes, of course, Tomek, guess
Tran,
what?
Yes, you were very close.
Very near. Now, last week, did you notice something missing last week, Steve? My cock was missing last week, and apparently a lot of people missed Mr. Cockerel. So today we have Mr. Cockerel back. So there we go.
There he is.
There are lots of fans of my cockerel. You have to be careful how you say that. That is disgusting.
It is, Mr. Duncan. It is disgusting. I berate you every week about that.
With my double entendre.
Yes.
For which I apologise almost. We must something now if we are to something. The something. The answer is... Ding dong.
Beat the rush.
Yes. We must leave now if we are to beat the rush. So shall we elaborate?
Yes, we're talking about traffic.
Yeah. So we must leave now. It is time to go. We must go now. Maybe we are hurrying, or maybe we need to move faster. If we are to beat the rush. So if you beat the rush, it means you get there before it becomes too busy. So Steve said traffic, but actually you can use it for anything, really. So maybe a shopping centre. So maybe if you go shopping on Saturday afternoon, there will be lots of people around. There will be lots of people rushing around. However, if you go in the morning on a Saturday, you might beat the rush before it becomes busy. So, yes, I like that one.
Emilio Lopez says hello from Panama.
Hello, Panama. Famous for its canal.
Yes.
And hats.
Yes, Panama hats. Mm. Yes, we
see, I'm a fan of hats. You may have noticed.
It's a particular style of hat that was certainly popular here in England. Mm. Not sure if it was... originated in Panama. It must have done. Tell us, so Emilio.
Yes.
Yes, you couldn't use the word road at the end of that one, but never mind.
No, next one. We're going to have another one. We'll try to squeeze two more in, as the actress said to the vicar. Another one, Steve. Another sentence game coming up right now. Oh, yeah. We decided to something our something something last year.
Ooh. I've got that one already.
Oh, really?
And I don't usually get them very quickly.
We decided to something our something.
I'm going to count down 10 seconds, and because Tomek will put the answer up.
Yes.
4, 3, 2, 1. No.
No, you've got to have... there is a 30-second delay anyway between this leaving our mouths and then it going into your ear. There is about 30-second delay. Well, there's a surprise. Tomek. Can we actually somehow... Is it possible to block Tomek without blocking him? Can we mute him? So don't take this personally, but you are sort of, you know,
you are correct,
pretty good at this, almost too good.
We decided to this is to do with relationships.
It's a bit like being banned from maybe a casino. So if you are very good at gambling and you keep winning money, what do they do? What does the casino normally do? So if you go to the casino and gamble and you always win money, you might get someone in a black suit coming up to you and suggesting perhaps you should just leave for a while. So, yes, something like this, you see. Maybe one of my henchmen.
This is for Nisa.
Yes. Oh, I see. Is it?
No, I'm only joking. Don't look. Don't look.
Nessar says, Mr. Steve is more handsome than me.
And he's put a picture of somebody with glasses on. Hence, I put these on.
Oh, that's why.
So if I want to read the live stream, I'm going to have to do that. How about that? Does that look trendy, Mr. Duncan?
That does not look trendy. It makes your head look even larger.
Thank you. Anyway,
back to the sentence game. The thing we are doing, we decided to something or something something last year. And now everyone is looking for Tomek's answer.
Bye, Unicorner.
Oh, Unicorina is going.
Unicorina, sorry.
Bye, Unicorina.
Unicornia. Going to do some housework.
Tomek says, I will withdraw from the game. Yes, I might have to send some of my henchmen. You know, like from a superhero movie, or maybe if there is a villain, he always has people working for him who do all of his dirty jobs, like killing his enemies.
Tran's got a good point. He's saying maybe Tomek is going into the future, watching the episodes of Mr. Duncan, and then returning with all the answers.
Yes.
Have you got a time machine?
Yes, Tomek? Maybe Tomek.
Tomek's just very clever.
Yes, maybe he is from the future. Maybe 5 years from now, there is a time machine. Can you tell us, Tomek, from the future, can you please tell us, when the hell is coronavirus going away? Could you just tell us now? Tell us what the cure is. You know, you could sort all this out in just 1 hour, I suppose. So that's what we need at the moment. We need a time traveller. If there are any time travellers watching at the moment, could you please put everything right? Oh, and also, can you tell me who wins the Super Bowl next year so I can put some money on it?
The answer's out there, Mr. Duncan. So
the answer is out there.
Need to move ahead.
Shall I get Mr. Cockerel to say hello? Here he comes right now.
Can I just say, can we have a new way of ending the sentence game?
Okay, then.
Next week.
For example, what?
I don't know. Just like a horn sound.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Or maybe Mr. Steve having a poo.
Mr. Duncan.
Oh, dear.
You're ridiculing me.
The cock's going off his mouth.
Mr. Duncan.
Oh, dear.
So what's the answer, Mr. Duncan?
Oh, yes, the answer. I got so distracted.
Put us back on.
I got so distracted. I got so distracted there.
We're back.
Is that what you wanted, Steve? Is that better? So instead of the cockerel, we will have Mr. Steve pushing out a big poo. That's what we're doing from now on. Oh, yes, of course, the sentence game, everyone. We decided to something or something something last year. The answer is...
Ding! Yes!
We decided to go our separate ways last year.
Maybe it's something I'll be saying... Maybe I'll be saying that next year, Mr. Duncan,
maybe.
On the live stream when I'm on my own, with my own channel.
With your own channel.
And someone says, where's Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
And I say...
But that will be your own inner monologue saying that. That'll be just you saying it to yourself. Where is Mr. Duncan? Where is Mr. Duncan? I miss him so much, the love of my life.
Can we squeeze one more in, Mr. Duncan?
Ooh. I wonder how many times you've said that in your life.
Not enough.
What?
Right. Oh. Double entendres, we don't want them.
This is a big one. It's a big one.
Okay.
Oh, look at the size of that.
One, two, three. Five words, Mr. Duncan.
It's a fiver.
Five words. Right. Well, we may need to call on Tomek.
Yes.
If nobody else gets this. But okay, we know then. We've got Tomek there waiting to help us all out, which is good to know. even though his wife's cooking, and he may go off at any minute to get to what's your wife cooking?
Yes,
Tomek.
That's what I want to know. I want to know what is your wife cooking?
What
is your wife cooking in the kitchen?
We want to know.
Can we come round? Can you spare some food for two poor, hungry urchins? Look at our eyes. Can you see the sadness in our eyes?
I something beginning with F.
I something the something performance something something very something. Ooh. But what could it be? We only have around 9 minutes left before we go.
I may go before that, Mr. Duncan. I'm feeling hungry. All I've had today is a bowl of porridge.
I'm feeling hungry. All I've had today is nothing.
I haven't
eaten anything today. I'm very hungry.
Mr. Duncan does this every Sunday. He's so busy preparing for the live stream, yeah. And I'm not joking. He has nothing to eat. And then, guess what? After the show, he just eats lots of junk food.
Do you know, because of the live stream today, I didn't sleep last night. I spent most of last night awake, up in front of my computer, editing Mr. Steve cooking in the kitchen. It took me all night to edit that. So I've only had about 2 hours sleep and nothing to eat. I can't believe I'm still standing, to be honest. So I something the something. Do we have any correct answers?
Well, I don't know the answer, but trans had a good go at getting some of these words. Is the first word found, Mr. Duncan? Maybe it's too early to reveal that. I found the trans is saying that could be found. Valeria said found as well.
Valeria. I love your name. It sounds like some distant planet. The planet Valeria.
There's a plant called valerium, isn't there?
There is.
And if you partake of the valerian plant,
yes,
it is said to help you sleep at night.
If you partake. Okay. If you say so. If you eat, but don't. Please don't eat anything from the garden.
It's supposed to make you sleepy.
Please don't go out into the garden now and eat the plants in your garden. Please don't do that, just in case. You know, it might be poisonous. It might be poisonous.
I don't think we've got the answer yet.
No. And Tomek, of course, has gone into exile. He's exiled himself.
We'll just click our fingers and Tomek will give us the answer.
Okay.
But not just yet. Not just yet.
Okay. Right. You know, someone's going to say that this is just fixed and that Tomek isn't even Tomek. He's just one of our relatives just pretending to be a viewer. Where do you think this is? The BBC? How dare you? How dare you? How dare
well,
you?
Well, we've got to go here with... let's have a look. Nisa has said found worst to be very.
Okay. You're not far off. That's very close.
Very close, Nisa, according to Mr. Duncan.
Where is my cousin, Tomek? Where is Tomek when we need him?
So we want the last word to be...
Well, it's nine. Think of something that makes you feel better. If you go to a performance, if you listen or watch, if you watch a performance, it might make you feel better afterwards. So I something the something performance, something something very...
Has Bella got it? Well, it could be right, what Bella said.
But it's the opposite word. So it's not something upsetting, it's the opposite.
So
something that makes you feel the opposite of upset. So instead of feeling depressed and deflated, you feel the opposite.
But Bella, that does fit.
Yes.
That does fit. But we can have another word at the end that makes it the opposite to upsetting.
I just wanted it to be positive, you see, because...
Marietta's got it.
Everyone is being so negative at
Tracy's got it.
Yes.
Maura's got it. Zika's got it. So well done, well done.
We have 4 minutes before we have to go, so let's have the answer. Would you like Mr. Steve pooping, or would you like the cockerel? Oh, a lot of people want the cockerel, and I don't blame you. No one, and I mean no one, wants to see Mr. Steve on the toilet. Not at all. So here we go. Here is the answer to the question, or the quiz, or the game, or whatever you want to call it, really.
Just realised I was very thirsty, Mr. Duncan.
Thirsty?
Vitas has got it as well.
The answer is... ding! I found the whole performance to be very uplifting. You see, so something that makes you feel happy. Maybe you hear a piece of music. Maybe you watch this. Maybe you watch our little show on the internet that we're doing now, coming out of your screen with pictures and sound. Maybe this is making you feel better.
Uplifted.
Maybe this is uplifting you.
I watched an uplifting performance last night.
Did you?
Which you wouldn't expect to be uplifting.
Okay.
It was... one of the very first performances, because of course theatres are closed at the moment, but there was a performance of Mozart's Requiem on television last night, a live performance.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Requiems are sad in a way, although they tend to end on a happy note.
Yes.
I found that uplifting because the music was wonderful, the singers were wonderful, the orchestra was wonderful, and it was just lovely to see.
Mm.
I mean, there was no audience, but they had photographs of people in the chairs, in the seats, in the auditorium. They had photographs of people that had written in saying they wanted to see the performance. So they got photographs of everybody, so you could see that it was like there were people there. Mm. Everyone was socially distanced. It was lovely.
How did the photograph allow them to see it, though? Did the photograph have a little camera where the eye was?
Maybe it did.
Maybe each photograph had a little web camera, and so that person could connect to their photograph, and it was almost as if they were there, even if it was only a photograph, with a hole in the front, with a web camera looking through it. It was almost like being there. A bit like this, really. It's about as real as this.
This is very real.
It certainly feels real. Well, Steve, guess what? We have come to the end of our 2 hours.
Are you hungry, Mr. Duncan?
I am a little bit hungry. I will have to be honest with you. I am slightly hungry at the moment. Yes, definitely hungry. So I think today we will do something different. We will go at the same time.
Okay.
Does that sound good? Because we only have 1 minute left. Let's just look at the clock. Oh, actually, we have about 3 minutes, but who's counting, really? Thank you for your company today. I hope you've enjoyed it. We've had a little bit of fun.
Tomek's having beetroot and carrot soup. That sounds nice.
Ooh.
I like carrot soup and I like beetroot. I've never tried that combination. With tacos, some vegetables and chicken. I'm getting the next flight over.
Mm.
That sounds lovely. Beetroot and carrot soup with tacos, some vegetables and chicken. Mm. You could have formed that into a sentence game.
Mm. Interesting.
Now, I'm feeling hungry. Is that making you feel hungry, Mr. Duncan?
It's making me feel slightly hungry, I'll be honest with you. Oh, by the way, we had a look at my socks earlier. So we can't have a live stream without looking at my lovely socks. There they are.
Mm, interesting.
Multicoloured with lots of squares. Blue, yellow, green, red. A little bit of navy blue at the end. But look, my feet are starting to fall in love. Ah, je t'aime, mon ami, je t'aime. Ooh, yes. Stop it, you disgusting feet. Did you see that? Did you see what they were doing, Steve?
I don't want to go anywhere near them, Mr. Duncan.
Terrible what they were doing there. They were getting all romantic. I thought any moment now those socks were going to come off and they would be doing it barefooted.
Duncan, you're always making sexual references on your show.
That's not sexual.
You're always making, what should we say, sort of naughty remarks.
Yes, that's not naughty. It's only naughty in your brain. It's not naughty when it's not naughty when it comes out of my mouth.
Oh, yes, it is.
It is not.
You know what you intended, Mr. Duncan.
It's your disgusting brain. Anyway, that's it. Time to go. We have about 40 seconds before we have to go. So thank you, Steve, for joining me today. It's been interesting. I will be having a well-deserved sleep later because I only had 2 hours sleep last night because I was editing the...
Marietta says, what do I mean by flying over? I mean, I'm going to catch an aeroplane to Tomek's house.
Yes.
So that I can have some of his food. Obviously, it's a joke.
Yes.
Because it would take too long to fly over there and the meal would be cold.
I think we know that you're joking. I don't think people believe that you're about to go to the airport and fly there. Also, if you fly somewhere, it means you go there in a hurry. So you fly to a place, you fly. It can also mean travel quickly.
Yes, fly over, not flight over. I'm going to fly over.
Okay,
in an aeroplane.
Okay, Steve, we are now running over. This is overtime now, and we don't get any extra jam on our tea cakes, no extra butter on our scones. We get nothing extra, you see, for doing overtime. So that's it. I hope you've enjoyed today's live stream. And I hope it's been interesting. We looked at vegetables. It's so tempting. In fact, you might say that you looked at two vegetables today. See you later. Thank you, Vitas. Thank you, Bloody Mary. Hello, Bloody Mary. I haven't seen you for a long time. Where the heck have you been?
Lolly Lolly was here as well.
Yes, Lolly Lolly.
I didn't see Lolly Lolly earlier.
Lolly pops up now and again, but I haven't seen Bloody Mary for a very long time. I love your name, by the way.
Anawat says, stay safe.
Stay safe, stay happy. Don't get too down. Don't worry. There is always light at the end of the tunnel. Things will get better. Always look on the bright side of life.
I always do that, Mr. Duncan.
Wow. And on that untrue note, we will see you later. I might be with you in the week. I'm not sure yet. I haven't decided. Might be with you in the week. But we will definitely be back next Sunday from 2 p.m. UK time. Is that a deal?
It is.
This is Mr. Duncan in the birthplace of English saying thanks for watching. You can watch all of this all over again. And yes, later on there will be captions. So please bear with me. There will be captions later on the recorded live stream. Anything you want to say, Steve?
No.
You know what's coming next. Yes, you do. Ta-ta for now.